Hi, good afternoon, everybody. I'm delighted to be here today with all of you. I'm Anu Prasad, Founder Director of India Leaders for Social Sector. We're a leadership and learning organization. I want to thank Sriram for giving me an opportunity to moderate this discussion, because I think this is a really important sort of topic that I'm delighted to be a part of, a part of the conversation. Given the pandemic, given the crisis, the social sector is going through a huge, huge sort of crisis in itself, an existential crisis in so many ways. Budgets are going to be slashed. A lot of HNIs are not feeling so, so supportive. I mean, there's a problem happening. CSR funding may be getting, diverted to COVID and other issues, and therefore, I think for us in the thing that's really been a very, very positive sign is the retail giving, the unprecedented uptick in the retail giving, and therefore I'm delighted that today I have a panel of people that are facilitating and fundraising for so many different issues, and so important, to be addressed. So I'm, without taking too much more time, we at ILSS really have been looking at, as an ecosystem, have been looking at two of the biggest pain points in the social sector. The first one being talent, but the second one being fundraising. And therefore, understanding the the kind of momentum we are seeing on retail fundraising is a wonderful sort of thing to look at and to understand and to see how we can build the momentum. So I'm going to introduce the panel today. There's Sandeep Talwar, CMO of Akshay Patra. Welcome, Sandeep. Varun Sheth of Keto, founder Keto. Priyanka Prakash of Give India. And Anuj Vishwanathan of Milab. Welcome to all of you. I'm going to first start with one question, which I'm going to ask all of you to sort of address in turn, which is really what have you seen in the last 2 months in terms of the fundraising, and how do we, because this COVID crisis isn't going to go away in a hurry. So it's a bit different from other crises that come upon. A, firstly, everyone's impacted. And B, this is a long drawn out, I mean, the reverberations of this crisis are going to be felt for a long time. So how do you see yourself sustaining this momentum? What are you thinking about? And I'd like to really start with Sandeep. Sandeep, could you share your thoughts?
Thanks, Anu. So I certainly think the giving momentum is here to stay. There has been a step change in the last 4 to 5 years in the attitude of people towards donations. Incomes in the past have gone up, they've increased. Donations, the way we all have been approaching to HNIs, individuals, corporates have changed. Secondly, there's a change in the image of the nonprofits too, right? Where the trust is slowly getting to build up now. And you can see that what was there in US and India, we're slowly trying to catch up with the US. No more I can see that the nonprofits are being turned back by the large corporates or the individuals. With COVID, however, there may be a blip or a downward spiral into the short term or medium term donations. Even emergency response, which is happening now, will soon start feeling the pinch of negative economic growth. But I think all of us have to probably today and henceforth in the future really have to look at much more innovative ideas to see how can we really bounce back. And I'm sure there are many more, and I'll talk much more about it in my session.
Sure. Can I request Varun to share your thoughts on how Keto has sort of address the crisis and what you're thinking of in terms of maintaining the sort of the momentum?
Sure. So in the last couple of months, of course, we've scaled our level of support servers to scale up the huge volume of inbound requests that we've seen. especially around COVID. In the last two months, we've now raised about 115 odd crores only around COVID. There are about 10,400 nonprofits raising funds on our platform. Of course, a lot of personal fundraisers as well. Our view is that, you know, what the impact of COVID and in terms of giving, what it has done, like the way we look at it is that it's creating the same shift that it's creating in groceries, you know, in general commerce, where people would go offline and buy groceries, at least 99% of the people, and only 1% would shop online. You've seen this whole shift of people now being getting comfortable about idea of buying groceries. So I see the same thing happening in giving as well, where there's a large volume of people who would give. They would give offline, they would go to temples, religious organizations. They would just give in an offline setup on a regular basis. But because now they can't go out, there is a shift where they feel like, I still want to do good, but I can't go anywhere and, you know, do good, or I can't go to the orphanage next to my house, which I would every Sunday, and help people. So I want to do it now online. So of course, given, as Sandeep said, income levels have gone up and, you know, all those good things have happened, more people have come online. But my view is that the whole idea of giving will just now take off from here. And even though income levels will come down, you will see that whole shift of offline to online giving happening. So maybe the pie might not increase significantly, but you will see how people give will change tremendously over the next 12 to 24 months.
That's fantastic and very encouraging. Thank you. Priyanka, could you share your thoughts?
Yeah, sure. I think I completely second with what Sandeep and Varun were speaking about. We've definitely seen a huge surge in the wave of givers, right? And personally, I feel that it's underpinned by the larger sense of empathy and solidarity that has come through across the nation. And I think the media narrative also helped a lot. I think another factor that has also helped this is also the presence of giving options across several, platforms or, places, right? Wherever consumers are present today, you will see that there's a giving option for COVID especially. And I think that is the shift that will hopefully help us to keep up the momentum. Because now, if you think about most people who can pay, who can donate, the ones who have the disposable income, they are on several apps, right? There are about 10 to 15 apps and platforms. Giving has to be incorporated across all of those platforms. And today, especially for COVID, that has happened. So that shift has happened, which I think was very instrumental in what happened in countries like China and US. So I do hope that that will really help to increase the momentum going forward. I also feel from an individual NGO perspective, it's very important for us to go back to the basics of, you know, understanding what motivates a giver and nurturing them. Because personally for us at Give India, we have seen that, you know, a new wave of new donors have come in, donors who probably haven't donated earlier. How do we nurture them? How do we, you know, build trust with them so that they also become burden holders for us going forward? I think will also be very key to keeping up the momentum going forward.
Anuj, your thoughts?
Yeah. I'll answer the second question first, which is, you know, how do we keep the momentum going? I think we are already seeing cues from the crowd. I always believe that the wisdom of crowd is supreme. At Milap, we launched this initiative for COVID on the day of Janta curfew, which was around March 22nd. It's been roughly 6-7 weeks. And we've seen how the kind of initiatives that come on board and get supported have just gone on to, you know, expand. To put this in perspective, the first 1 to 2 weeks, a majority of the initiatives that people were fundraising were for immediate relief, like provision of meals and daily essentials, along with medical supplies per se. Somewhere, you know, around mid-April, when people realized that this is going to be a larger, sort of calamity, if I may put the word, the shift also expanded to things like people started doing things that you would never otherwise look at. Like, for example, direct cash transfers to people who have been affected by economic downturn, like, you know, cab drivers, you know, restaurant workers, etc., etc. So, you know, campaigns were being run for them, NGOs were helping them, and money was being raised and going on. We started seeing a lot of gratitude campaigns, right? People that you would otherwise not think about, conservancy workers, paramedical staff, etc. And now what we are seeing is the focus is now expanded to rehab. The new set of initiatives that are coming is more towards rehabilitation, which is essentially, hey, migrant workers are back in their hometowns. How do we engage in their livelihoods? How can, you know, we support their livelihoods? And it's not just about, you know, people coming with these demands, NGOs coming and setting it up. It's also the fact that they are able to mobilize that support. So I think from a momentum perspective, you know, it will continue. Of course, any large scale event will see those spikes. But what was pleasantly surprising to us as a platform was, unlike the previous, you know, if I were to, you know, equate it to a natural disaster, is the fact that it has not just focused on relief, like immediate relief, but has gone beyond that, where people are also now open to the idea of supporting rehabilitation, livelihoods, etc. In a way, what you would also think as capacity building, or I can't see it per se. So that's a good sort of a sign. And I, you know, I've seen that in terms of, like Priyanka said, the empathy levels have gone high. And this was probably the first time when all of us were affected in one way or another. Every other time, it's either some part of the geography getting affected and so on. This is probably the first time that entire India was. And I think that, you know, that experience is here to stay. And as long as, you know, we remain authentic to the cause and needs, I think irrespective of how the economic, you know, impact is going to be, I think the giving will still continue to grow.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's a wonderful optimistic note. I completely resonate with that. I think my own personal giving has evolved in such a wonderful way. And I see that around communities that we live in. Direct bank transfers also happening, like I discussed with you, Anuj, and that was a first, you know, for me. But I think I would really like to believe that once the crisis doesn't become a new normal, and then this muscle of giving that has been invoked in a big way across the country stays on. I actually wanted to understand some numbers, but would you be okay to share just what it's been in terms of numbers? And I'll go back to Anuj, you and, you know, back to the others, just in this, just to show the
update. Yeah. Sure. I think for COVID, we've launched three separate initiatives. One is essentially for relief. The other one is essentially specifically focused for healthcare workers. And the third one is for small business rehab for small businesses. I mean, put together, we've raised close to 96 crores. This is series of individuals, HNIs, and also some CSR funds facilitated through the platform. Around 4,500 unique initiatives are being fundraised. I think NGOs constitute to almost 40% of those in terms of the number of campaigns, and close to 200,000 donors have contributed, a vast majority of them being first-time donors.
Wow, fantastic. Varun?
Yeah, so since we've launched the COVID aspect on our platform, again, we've seen, as Anuj rightly mentioned, businesses, you know, nonprofits, medical professionals. We've seen about close to about 110 crores we've raised. We have about 6,000 odd fundraisers running. 80% is nonprofits. About 10,000 odd nonprofits are on our platform, fundraising either jointly with other nonprofits or individually. We've seen a lot of collaboration among nonprofits on the platform as well, where two, three nonprofits combine raising funds and executing projects. That's something that we've seen for the first time. In terms of volume of donors, we've seen about around 3.5 lakh odd donors on our platform. It's been a mix. Actually, we've seen a large volume of people coming and just giving for COVID, which are a part of our donor ecosystem. So we've seen a large volume of repeat. A lot of people were not given for like 4 years, 5 years, or just given once a long time back, coming back and making contribution. So just reactivating this universe that we have. And of course, we've seen a good volume of people coming and giving. The interesting part is that we've seen a decent volume of people giving from outside India, which was a bit surprising because COVID is something which has impacted all the countries, right? So we've seen a decent volume of people coming giving from Middle East, from the US, UK, Southeast Asia as well, wanting to, you know, help back, even though I'm sure the situation over there is also not very good. So that was a little surprising. We didn't think that we would get so many people from NRIs or from outside India coming forward and making contributions.
Priyanka?
Yeah, we also launched, you know, our initiatives on March 22nd. I remember working just that weekend and launching our missions. And just across our retail missions, again, these are very promising. This is a promising time. We raised close to, I think, 45 to 50 crores only from retail giving, from our own platform and also our partnerships with several payment and leading payment partners such as PhonePe, Google Pay, and also on Facebook and several retail partners like that. We saw a wave of close to, I would say, about 2.75 lakhs retail donors, individual donors. And that has been probably the most encouraging thing for us at Give India. From our areas focus, we have focused across three areas. One is humanitarian, which is rations and food, direct cash assistance, which is our one of our most successful missions, and also healthcare. Apart from this retail giving, I think both Anuj and Varun mentioned, we've seen a wave of giving come from CSR corporates and also several other partnerships that we have done, and also from the diaspora, which again comes up to another 100 to 110 crores. And I think, the sense of support has come from across the board.
Varun spoke about collaboration between nonprofits and so on. I also want to point out that we have, like, for example, we've been working with Give India for some of the, you know, initiatives as well, you know, so it's collaboration, not just between nonprofits, but also between platforms per se in some of these, major initiatives.
No, I do think that the whole Charcha 2020 is one giant collaboration of the entire sector coming together. So I think collaboration has been one big sort of wonderful thing that's come out of an unfortunate crisis. Sandeep, could you share just some numbers of what it's been fundraising this last month?
I think I've been a lucky guy because I've been a neutral player. And
Sandeep, you'll need to speak a bit louder, just a bit louder. I'm not able to hear you very clearly.
So I'm saying I have been a very lucky guy, and I had Give India and K2 both giving support to us. Through our corporate fundraising this time has not been so great, and deliberately we did not go to our corporates for a reason, because we have 1.8 million children who need to ensure feeding to start from August or September at the max, right? So the existing donations had to renew. So we were very, very clear with them that the existing MOUs have to be renewed and our monies have to continue, because that itself is about 200 crores of money. And I cannot put that at stake at any point of time because of disaster. But yes, the numbers have been very close to about 90 crores, including the retail donations. Retail donations have been not so great, but to the tune of about 15 crores for us. By now, the last about six, seven weeks now.
So just coming to the, you know, just a follow-up question to you, Sandeep, with CSR funding likely to sort of dry up, I mean, companies are not doing very well. For a lot of the NGOs that we are sort of around, we do advise them that this year may still be okay. Next year is where you're really going to face issues. What kind of capabilities do you suggest? Because Akshay Patra has really done a phenomenal job of their fundraising. And I also want to touch upon diaspora at some point. But what kind of best practices, what kind of talent do you think would be something we need to develop? As an organization, what would you sort of share as your insights?
Thanks Anu, for the appreciation. And I agree that the upcoming months will be very, very challenging for all of us, you know. So what we need to do is what we all have not done by now, and that is brand. I think we all need to focus on brand, and I believe that if the people on the other end start trusting our brand, then things will start making a difference, right? What Tito is today or Give India is today could have happened only because of the effort they put on ground, right? And they build that brand for themselves, right? So we've also tried to do that. And I think Akshay Patra is a good brand today and a well-established brand today. And we've been focusing on our brand for the last 2-3 years. Digital marketing, we started only very recently, about 6 years ago. And we started to build up in the last 2 years for us. And I know that's one of the tools which we need to really invest this year and the next year too heavily. Partnerships is going to be the new answer for all of us, right? I don't think so. Any of us can ignore partnerships, you know. And we've seen that there are people Give India, while they partnered with the ATE and they partnered with Google, and they got huge amount of grants from them, and we realized that, right? Better relationships, because as Akshay Patra, we realize 73% of my donations come from corporate houses. So relationships will be the answer for Akshay Patra, you know, because for me, that is my bread and butter. And that's where I need to look at ensuring there's a better relationship there. And that's where we're trying to invest on more people. On one end, you know, you would have heard that people, there are a lot of NGOs are asking people to go. Akshay Patra is hiring, you know, in the last 7 weeks, we have hired 19 fundraisers by now. Right? So we are building up the fundraising team very big way. Fortunately, we also had launched an internal academy, learning academy. And that's where we focus a lot on skilling of the people. Among one of the 19, and we have also hired a sales coach now. The job of this guy is to go along with the team and skill the ways of selling and ensuring standardization. And I think most of us have to do it. We really can't probably afford to do that. If the corporates have been doing it, it's time for NGOs to really look at it and probably replicate that model. Cost cuttings, yes. We need to look at the flap. Leaders must guide their teams towards the goals that lead to concurrence with the current reality. We need to relook at volunteering in a big way, because PRG and volunteering had been one big channel for us, especially for the multinational companies, right? Because most of the multinational companies only pay you money when you make volunteering to happen. And I think that's another channel we need to look at it in the current. So overall, I think people will always make a difference. Now we need to look at how do we really make them engage with the donors in a big way. It may be digitally, I think the way we are talking, but I think we need to keep the engagement very, very high.
That's fantastic, Sandeep. Clearly, you all have been very, very far-sighted in planning your fundraising, and that's why, you know, Akshay Patra is where it is. So thank you for sharing that. Varun, a question to you. How do you understand donor sentiment? What prompts them to give? Could you share, you know, what are some really good donor relationship management practices that you sort of seen in your experience that you could share with us?
Sure. So, of course, that question is very large. I think it really depends from cause to cause, right? So, sure. If I have to just talk about medical fundraising, you know, sure. Which is a large part of what we do, we've seen what helps retain donors is that if somebody is given money for someone's medical treatment, if the donor is able gets an update under 60 days, you know, that becomes extremely meaningful and impactful for the donor, because sending a report after 90 days or 100 days, the drop rate is extremely high. So how do you send a report or information as quickly as possible in a concise manner, in an easy manner to consume? And with medical fundraising, it's generally not very complex to communicate the impact that you've created. All they want to know is that has the patient been successfully treated or not? You know, that's it. It's very simple. You know, it's not that they're in the middle of, you know, educating and they're in this class or that class. So measuring success is extremely easy for donors there, which basically drives impact and a feel-good factor. In terms of best practices that we've seen, because we work with a lot of nonprofits, of course, every nonprofit has their own strategy of how they want to engage and keep their donors engaged over a period of time. But having a strong communication touch point cycle is extremely important. I think that's something everybody knows, you know, how many times to communicate, how often to communicate, what all mediums to use. And given the mediums have increased significantly today, you know, you have Facebook and you have WhatsApp and of course email, SMS. You know, how do you communicate and when to communicate is extremely important. So understanding your own donor cohorts that, you know, maybe some people want to be communicated only once a year. Maybe some want to be communicated 60 days, some want to be communicated every 90 days. So that's very, very, very important. Learning from your data in terms of not treating all your donors the same. There is no one simple vanilla formula that can be put across to your whole donor ecosystem. So the more you learn about how which audience wants to be engaged, I think the better the retention and the better engagement that you see with your audience. So I think that's the most important thing. And I think if you look at the most successful nonprofits globally, we always look at St. Jude's, right? Because they're one of the biggest nonprofits in the US. They raise $1 billion only in retail fundraising, have a massive team. And I think if you read about them, their annual reports and, you know, the whole journey over the last few decades, you'll see that what they've done really right in terms of retaining donors has been creating the cohorts. And of course, over a period of time, going from one time giving to how do you get them to become regular donors, right? I think that's something that has still not opened up in India. And I believe that after this COVID scenario and all these people coming in giving online, that opportunity will open up for nonprofits like Akshaya Patra and other nonprofits that do look at regular giving or monthly giving. So I believe that over a period of time, nonprofits need to have a strategy that, okay, we spend a lot one time, acquire the donor. We need to make sure how do we bucket this donor and engage them. And then over a period of time, how do they move across channels and become regular donors? And once they become regular donors, what is the strategy then to retain them? And once you retain them over a, you know, 4, 5, 10 year period, then how do you go into their bequests, right? How do they get in the will that some part of the money gets left, you know, in after they pass away? So there's a whole journey over there. And I've personally spent a lot of time with a lot of these larger nonprofits to understand how do they do it successfully. So yeah, it's not one thing. I think it's like nonprofits maybe need to look at it as like as a 30, 40, 50 year journey. How do you get the journey together? You know? So I think it's a mix of a lot. And I think there are good tools available as well. There are good CRM tools available now. And I think if the right technology tools is used, and of course the right investment in people, because that's where, you know, most nonprofits fall short, is they'll buy the most expensive tool or they'll get it for free from Microsoft or Salesforce. But then you need the right people also. You can get the best car, but Formula One car, but if I'm driving it, you're not going to win any championship and races, you know? So you need to get, you know, the right drivers in there as well to make sure they use the resources in the right manner. And of course, then it's a long-term game that you need to, I think, figure out over a period of time what works. Get volunteers in. Volunteers are the best source of fundraising or crowdfunding for any nonprofit, not only in India, but, you know, even outside India. So I think, if all these things, look at it, and if the management has a long-term view, I think there is a lot of exciting things that can be done in retail fundraising by nonprofits.
Thank you. That's fantastic, Varun. In fact, I'm almost going to complain to Sriram. He needed to give me 2 hours. This is such a vast topic, and it's not enough that, you know, there are so many questions, even while you're answering questions that I want to ask, but I know that there's paucity of time. So Priyanka, and by the way, while I was doing this, I got a notification from Milap. So I just wanted to let you know, Anuj, like giving me some, you know, some updates. So I was like amused it came at a timely time. Priyanka, the question to you would be, what kind of options? Retail is a vast space. So could you just, you know, for people that are in the audience, probably trying to understand this space, a lot of social sector organizations that are hurting and are looking at retail. So could you share with us, in, you know, what are the different kinds of retail fundraising? A little bit about crowdfunding, subscription, regular giving. Could you share with us?
So I think before answering that question, something related I want to talk about is what Sandeep brought up earlier, right? I think building brand now and social trust is so important. And I that is, I think, the key to how we're going to sustain over the next few years. In terms of just what are the options available, obviously, you know, as NGOs, I'm pretty sure most of the NGOs are out there already with their network of donors doing one-time and subscription options. What is key is now that you have all these surge of donors, how do we engage with them? How do we nurture them? Like Varun rightly mentioned, you know, we need to have a clear path to, you know, moving them down the funnel to a subscription donor. And once he's a subscription donor, how do we get him to realize that, okay, he can make multiple options? I think for all this is different across different platforms, how do we inspire trust, right? That is one key thing. Apart from that, Sandeep also mentioned earlier, partnerships is going to be very, very key now. For example, Give India recently did a partnership with, called I for India, which brought in most of the celebrities in India for the first time. I think we have to get very creative with how can we be where most of the consumers are spending their time. And we have to be very cognizant of the fact that there are only few key things that most consumers do, most of us do. We're spending time on TV, we're spending time on Netflix, Yahoo, phone pay payment apps or, you know, e-commerce apps, and we're on Facebook. So we have to identify these places where, you know, consumers are already spending time. Once we identify that, the brand piece becomes very important, right? Because, you know, there could be so many of us out there. How can you stand out once you're on all of these platforms? It's very important. So I think collaborations, inspiring trust to do collaborations with large entities, I think those two things are very important going forward.
Thank you. Anuj, are there any specific causes that donors most empathize with? You know, could you just share with us some two, three that you feel that really get very, and then of course, how do we diversify? I mean, one of the things that I have seen, which has been really reassuring, is just the extent of different kinds of fundraising that's happening. I mean, I saw the trans women in Hyderabad, that was phenomenal on Keto. And then, you know, just the stuff you're doing with animal shelter and animal, I mean, it's amazing, but I just wanted to understand what are like the top three in your understanding that are, you're on a mute. Anuj, you're on mute.
Sorry. Yeah. I think there is a pre-COVID and a post-COVID answer to it. And I'm very honest about it because, like I said, in my initial, statement, the kind of causes and the wisdom of crowd in understanding what the needs are has moved from immediate relief to things around gratitude, right? Like something like, I'm grateful for this conservancy worker who's working in my, area or in some area or other, et cetera. So I think if you asked me pre-COVID, of course, I would have, spoken about certain causes. And my simplest answer has always been, close your eyes. Can you think what is the before and, there is this money and what would be the after? The before after effect is what I always talk about, right? Things that are, straightforward in terms of before after are the ones that resonate with retail givers. That has been, our experience so far, and which is what has been also validated by what Varun was talking about when it comes to medical treatments or providing for meals, etc. But I think this is one opportunity that we are seeing where people are able to, yes, it's a beginning, but it's something that is very surprising. We've been around for 10 years in this journey. This is probably the first time that we are seeing things like where people are saying, hey, there are migrant workers who are going back to their states. They do not have skills. They do not have jobs. And here is an organization that is helping them pick skills, entrepreneurship skills, so that they can set up small businesses. Like, we've never seen where capacity building for, you know, individuals as a cause being able to resonate with audience. So that's our experience. I mean, we'll see how this translates over the next 6-8 months. But the bottom line is, irrespective of which cause that you're working on, I think now is an opportunity where if your cause or if your communication is able to resonate with the audience at large, because we are all affected by the same, you know, environment, I think there is the cause really takes, you know, a secondary step, you know, backseat. The primary thing is how authentic is it, so to say. So that would be my explanation around, you know, the cause specifically.
Thanks. I want to come back to Sandeep. You know, and Varun touched upon the whole diaspora funding, but Akshay Patra is really one of the NGOs that is, I think, other than Pratham, that is phenomenal, has a phenomenal presence in the diaspora, you know, space. I mean, I'm on Facebook and I see people in Texas and all doing Akshay Patra sort of fundraising, and it's wonderful. So how has your experience through COVID been with the diaspora? I mean, are they funding Akshay Patra or, I mean, I've seen some, but I still want to hear that from you. And how do you plan to grow it even further? Or do you have any plans because this is, how do you see this funding? And then what are your thoughts on going forward? And how much of it has come to India, you know?
So back to the reality is Akshay Patra by now and so far has been restricted to only two markets, which is US and UK, right? So our primary mode of outreach was community oriented, largely offline events, which are called gala. And we've been doing it quite successfully, both in US and UK through our volunteers and chapters. So that has made quite success for us in the past. Now, with the last 7 weeks, I think there's been a hit. In fact, two galas which were planned in US. One was in LA itself. One was supposed to be one of the biggest gala event, was badly impacted. But I think we turned around very well. And I would like to appreciate our CEO based out of US. And I think the way she embraced the technology and ensured 1,000+ families came on, they logged on. I remember that night I was all up and there was a huge amount of chat which was live, and we were thriving with those chats. People paid for it. It was not a free, let me first tell you. It was people paid for it and then they came in. So we covered up for that, I think. And now we have series of events which are lined up now, one after the other. Fortunately, we have good celebrities also coming on board. Chef Sanjeev Kapoor is there now, then Hrithik Roshan who's come forward, right? Ravina Tandon has come forward, Vikas Khanna, Chef Vikas Khanna has come forward. Like, these are many celebrities coming forward because they understand it's time that we need to support these kind of organizations who are doing a good amount of work to really make the to really feed the needy, you know. And I think one of the points which most of us really understand is that hunger is bigger than COVID. That's a reality, right? I don't know how many of us know, right, that 5,000 children in India die every day because of hunger, right? That's not what coronavirus has done, right? And on the other side, I keep telling people and to my donors and everyone, right, the likely chances of a hungry person getting impacted because of corona are much, much, much more higher than not giving a food to somebody. So I think the emotion behind food, the emotion behind hunger, and it's really making sense for us. And I think that connects the donor, that connects the diaspora back to India. They love to hear about the beneficiaries. They love to interact with them, and I think that's where the attraction has been for us in the last 3-4 years in US and UK.
Are you planning to expand your?
Not made a large success like Pratham has. We're still calling up Pratham.
Okay. are you? So are you expanding, are you looking at expanding to other countries as well, given the success of
We are, and that's why we are looking at, we've done registration in Canada, Europe, and Dubai. So these are three markets we should be opening up in this year. Registration takes some more time in these countries, and that's where we have completed. So most likely this year, ideally we should have done it, but then that is going to get delayed a bit, but you will be there.
Varun, another very large question to you. This is the Finance Act and the the sort of implications on the social sector, and in particular, you know, with the NGOs, you know, requiring to reapply every 5 years, etc. What do you think this environment, how do you think it's going to impact the sector?
I think the fact that nonprofits need to re-register themselves and get their ATG again, I think it's a good thing, because India has so many nonprofits and no one knows how many are active and not active and dormant. And I'm sure hundreds and thousands of nonprofits have ATG as well. So I think it'll clean up the sector. So it's a good thing that nonprofits need to re-register themselves and get compliant again. So I think that's a good step. I think the challenge would be when it comes to retail fundraising and in terms of how much information, donor information, do nonprofits need to capture, and how to basically make sure that information is accurate as well. Because one thing is asking for information and people giving information. Second is people giving accurate information. So I think there is a lack of clarity there in terms of what is exactly going to happen. Come tax filing year, or maybe a year down assessment time, do income tax officials, you know, open up donor list and say, hey, where are the PAN numbers of all these donors? And, you know, if some person in PAN number has just put ABCDF, somebody is giving 100 rupees, you know, and does not really care about getting an ATG as well, you know, what happens then, right? Because there's no open database to pull out and verify if somebody is giving the right PAN. And what if somebody is donating on somebody else's behalf? And there's a lot of permutation combinations to that, because we do see a lot of people donate, gifting or making a gift donation on other people's names. there's a lack of clarity. And I think nonprofits also still figuring out what all information they have to capture and how to verify it as well. So I think over the next 12 months, we will know more. But at this point, I think most nonprofits are just doing what they think is they should be doing to be on the right side of the law, you know. So capturing addresses, capturing PANs, PAN number, asking for PAN card images. Different nonprofits doing different stuff. And I think over the next 12 months, there will be much more clarity. But my only point is that the minute if somebody giving 100 rupees or 500 rupees needs to start giving their PAN, you will definitely see a massive drop in terms of people giving, because that's what we've seen, where nonprofits are asking for PAN number for any amount of giving. We see a drop rate in terms of only the serious donors who want to give a large amount land up giving, but the people, the small ticket size, the crowd who wants to give 100, 500, 1,000 rupees, just see that it's too much effort and just drop out. And plus the question really is also, how comfortable they are in terms of giving all this information also to nonprofits, you know? That's a very important part.
Sure.
Their PAN number or the address. Are they comfortable sharing all that information? Given, you know, privacy is such a big conversation in today's world. They might not be comfortable sharing that information also.
I'm going to ask two more questions of Priyanka and Anuj, and then I'm going to, because I know there are audience questions and we have about 15 minutes. So, Priyanka, payroll giving, employee giving, could you share a little bit about, you know, how that, what that's been for you in this time period, and what you're like, if you have any thoughts about corporate engagement and buy-in on this?
As many of you would know, Givindra is actually a 20-year-old organization now, and we started out with employee giving as one of our key verticals back in 2000. We started inside ICICI's office when Mr. Vagul supported us. I think we've evolved. We now have about over 150 corporates who engage with us for employee giving. I think the way it has evolved is at one point, it was a lot of philanthropists who were at the helm of institutions and corporates who would say that I want to build a giving culture and let's do it with employee giving. But I think as the years have moved on, we've seen that many individuals want to be associated and work at a place where, you know, the organization is a socially conscious brand. And employee engagement has become one of the key pieces as well. So corporates coming in and saying that I want to be perceived as a, you know, brand with my employees in a way that, you know, they think of us as a brand that is socially aware, supportive of our communities, and engaging their employees again in the same thing. I think that has been a key factor in increasing the number of corporates coming into this fold. Of course, CSR, corporate social responsibility, is another piece that has also helped corporates to come in as a mandate, right? Where we've seen good developments is we've realized that when we used to do corporate employee giving as a sort of offline event-driven piece, the number of employees coming in to sign up was far lower. Last year, GiveIndia introduced a completely productized version of employee giving where, the experience would be seamless, where people would come in and see, here's everything my organization is supporting, and maybe here are some more, and I can support them. And like many of the others spoke about here, I think the key to keeping them for and increasing the number of people joining that program has been the fact that we've been very diligent in providing transparent reports and updates. For example, if somebody has supported education of a girl child, we even send her marks cards to him, you know. And we've received so many great messages about, oh my God, this makes me feel like I'm part of the impact, right? Making the impact real to them through reporting and updates has been also very key to developing this. I think corporates also have evolved towards, you know, developing more engaging and volunteering options. From an engagement lens, I think GiveIndia has pioneered something called WishTree that our head of employee giving, Somdatta, has been driving across all of the corporates that we are engaged with, where, going back to the basics, making giving has to be very simple, right? I have to be able to relate to what I'm giving. Is it a meal? Is it a textbook? Is it education, uniform? What is it, right? Very simple things. And I think WishTree has been one concept that most of our corporates have picked up, where we say that, you know, here's a WishTree of children wanting, you know, school bags, children wanting meals for 20 days, or somebody wanting a clutch, whatever, what have you, right? Simple ways for them to give. And on the payment side, also making it very easy for them in at corporates to pay. And I think this has been very engaging. Then we've also had corporates who engage the entire employees together in one whole day of gala events where they say that, you know, why don't we all do a potluck? We had one corporate who brought in about 10,000 to 15,000 employees across three locations to one whole day of charity fundraising. While that is fundraising, it was it also took the mark of engaging their entire employee base in one day. So I feel corporate giving, one is productization of the whole piece, and keep sticking to the same, you know, aspects of trust, transparency, giving them clarity on how the funds are utilized, how are you making an impact. And lastly, about making it more engaging, the corporates have to also at the end of the day feel that this investment is not just about CSR or, you know, impact, it's also about engaging my own employees. So NGOs have, as NGOs and as platforms, we have to understand what do they need out of this as well. And that is something that we consciously try to work on so that it's successful for them, not just from a CSR perspective, but also from an employee engagement perspective.
There's a wonderful question that has come for Anuj, but I'm actually going to ask both Anuj and Varun this question. Many campaigns tend to drive emotional engagement through images and language that seems to compromise the dignity and agency of the beneficiaries, overplaying poverty, misery, etc. How can we infuse dignity in fundraising, especially in online giving? This is something we all grappled with, and I'd love to hear your thoughts and Varun's on this.
Yeah, I think, speaking from Milab's experience as such, over the years that we have, worked on crowdfunding and specifically, one-to-one crowdfunding per se, One of the things essentially, you know, we always talk about, you know, why giving hasn't grown is the, you know, the lack of trust, right? You know, the whole black box, you know, I'm giving this money. Does this money actually go to this person? Will they actually benefit from this? You know, that's the question that, you know, keeps coming up in many of our minds, right? And what crowdfunding and specifically, you know, person-to-person, you know, crowdfunding has enabled is the ability for you to know who this person is, right? Of course, when you are talking about somebody who has a need, let's say a medical emergency, et cetera, per se, obviously, when you are working towards telling that story, you have to be authentic. But at the same time, you also have to ensure that the recipient on the other side is also aware of the fact that this is going on social media and people are people are contributing to their stories, etc. So some of the things that we've put in place is, you know, consent, which is a written consent in local language as well as, you know, Hindi per se, if they speak Hindi, that they know what, you know, if before their story goes up, that they provide that consent per se. And we also walk them through a sample set of stories, etc., saying that, you know, this is the page, this is where your stories are going to be, and this is what we are going to essentially communicate to the world. So all of these stories, all of these things essentially have a sort of a consent. And eventually, you know, the idea essentially is once, like, you know, Varun spoke before, once people get comfortable with the idea of giving, and we've already seen that in certain, you know, some cases as well, where people focus more about, you know, how their lives were before as opposed to how their lives are now. And that is able to connect with the, you know, the larger donors per se. So we are moving in that direction. But we also have to understand that where we are starting from is probably 20 years behind as to what it was, let's say, in the US or UK. So this is not unique to India as such. What organizations like Milap and other platforms have to do is to ensure that we have adequate systems in place that respects consent, that respects privacy, and promotes the transparency for the recipient. So it's not just a one way. And that's something that we take very seriously before putting up any story on social media.
Varun, would you like to share something?
Yeah, I completely agree with Anuj. Even at Keto, we make sure that we take a consent. We make sure they see the story before it is put up. It goes live on the website. Even the images that we take or they share are with 100% consent. What we need to understand is that India is very early in terms of its giving journey. And the way we look at the audience is that there is a large volume of audience on Keto who we don't need to show such content, or maybe who are not interested to see such content, but they just come and contribute on a monthly basis, you know, because they are those donors who they are the most, say, I would say, organized or most committed donors, where they don't need to be pushed. They will just come once a month, make a contribution, or once every 2 days, or once a week, whatever the number is. But there's a large amount of audience which is still not giving online. And we believe that, at least from what we've seen, is that emotional content drives people to give. You know, there's no reason that either Milap or Keto or any third platform would push out emotional content if it was not working. It drives and opens up bigger audiences to come and contribute on Keto. And we believe that, at least in terms of giving, this is a concept which is still prevalent in the US. You know, if you go to the US, you'll see St. Jude's ads and you'll see St. Jude's content on YouTube or Facebook or anywhere. And this is a country where retail fundraising, probably like 100, 200 million people are giving online, you know, and they still need to show emotional content. So I feel like it really comes down to audience. I think the more audience which are way ahead in terms of the journey of giving, don't need to be shown such content. They will still come and contribute. And we try to do that. But of course, through Facebook and Google or YouTube, we can't control 100% of the universe. We're limited in terms of how they allow us to target people. But then there's a certain audience which we want to get on our platform. We want them to come and contribute, for which emotional content becomes an important part of the journey.
We have two wonderful questions for both Priyanka and Sandeep, but we are out of time. I'm really sorry that this, we will have to sort of end our session here because I think the next session's around the corner. So I'll send you all the questions anyways, because I think they were brilliant questions and I would have loved to discuss them. So thank you guys. This is you. Like, I never tire of saying you are the great white shining hope for the sector, because there is, you know, this, I pray that this retail giving really grows, and there's so much potential to grow, and everyone should be contributing. Thank you very much for being here today and sharing your insights and your learning with us. And thank you, Sriram. This was a wonderful session, a lot of learning for me at ILSS. We're planning to, roll out the fundraising sort of learning soon. So, yeah, thank you very much, and all the best.
Thank you.